In a world where Microsoft virtualization is still considered to be the underdog by some. The Hyper-V Amigos enlightened the IT crowds on how they could very well be mistaken.
Hi Didier, my friend, how are you?
Well, I'm good. It's snowing outside. I went for a snow walk. I'm in my comfy home office and we're going to play with STD. So
don't say that. I have so much snow on top of my car. So,
but it's maybe now
you are in Belgium and you are near the water, right? So you are maybe at 100 meters above sea level?
Not even.
I'm at 450 here.
The highest point in my city is 32 meters.
32. Okay.
And that's the highest point.
My city, the lowest point is 450 meters. And we are in the Sauerland. It's known in the past for snow. And we have some skiing possibilities here. And we have a lot of snow. So it's amazing. But it's warm in my office. So let's do this show. And it is a while, right?
It's been a while.
We did our last show, I think, in January this year.
It's because we've been so busy.
Yeah, it is because I was so busy. I think.
What are you insinuating?
Yeah, that you are not busy. No, it's mostly my fault because I was so busy. But we said, let's do this nice showcast again. And we got some nice comments on our past shows on YouTube, right?
Yes, we did. I saw those. That was very nice.
Yeah. So if you like our shows, please give us feedback. Give us feedback at Twitter or at YouTube where the shows are available. Okay, but we have a very, very, very long list of things we want to show. So let's start. And our topic today is, Didier?
STD with VMFleet.
Exactly. So first, VMFleet. A little bit. Let's a little bit elaborate about what's VMFleet for. We have these nice storage spaces direct systems, and we do a lot of them. And as always with storage, you don't know how much your storage system can, let's say, deliver. How fast it is. How much I/O you get on the system. How much latency you get. And yep. Microsoft has a very nice test suite. It's a bunch of PowerShell scripts. It's called VMFleet, and it's actually part of the disk speed test tool. Yeah, and you can deploy VMFleet on a hyperconverged S2D scenario and really figure out what's going on there. So let's put it that way. It's a 20,000 feet view on VMFleet, and I use it a lot when we use it a lot when we do storage spaces direct implementations to really show the customer what their system can do and if there is something wrong with it. We have found some misconfigurations, wrong drivers, and so on when we use VMFleet. Because you never know how much your storage system can, or your hyperconverged storage system can achieve, except you do some testing, right?
So basically, based on the outcome of your tests, you can say, look, this really should be better, and then you go and dive in, and you find out, okay, we don't have the correct drivers, or we've forgotten something, stuff like that. You mean?
That's exactly true. I have written a post on our blog, the Hyper-V server DE blog, where I was at a customer who had a very nice all flash deployment with nearly 10 terabyte of NVMEs in every system and 20 terabytes of SSDs, and it was a 4-node cluster, and we did VMFleet, our usual tests, and we got 120,000 8K IOs with 30% write part and 70% read. And if you look at that without the comparison to other systems, you said, oh, that's not bad. 120,000 IOPS with 4 nodes. Yeah. But I actually had done a test with a much a cheaper system 2 weeks before that. It had only two small NVMEs, a little bit SSD, and a lot of HDDs, and we got 110,000 IOPS out of it.
And so
something was off there, and we actually found the problem. It was the NVMe drivers. I post about it at the blog, and we got four times the performance only by changing the NVMe driver. So the system at the end had 500,000 8K IOPS with 30% write part. So it's an increasement of, how you say it, 400%.
Yeah, that's significant. Let's put it that
way. Significant, and even the latency got down a lot. So I highly advise people to test their systems, and I know you do that a lot, right?
Oh yeah, we live by testing and verifying. So the mantra we live by is trust but verify.
Okay. So and VMfleet, the nice thing is, so usually we test also with a VM we call benchmark VM, and there is an IO meter in it, and we had it in previous shows where you can see nicely how much IO one VM can do with this gauge, and you see that's nice, but you can't really stress a system with, for example, four nodes with one benchmark VM.
It doesn't scale, basically. Yeah, it's exactly. It's nice visually. I still use that actually, because I always try to test in different ways to have several parameters, several ways of seeing what's going on. So I still use that. But this CASPD, of course, has the potential to scale a bit better.
Yeah. I always use the IO meter. I like it to show what one VM can do and test it. Yeah. And you can use IO meter in a virtual machine everywhere. VMfleet is only designed for a hyperconverged S2D setup. And I will explain why. You can't really use VMfleet to test a converged storage spaces direct setup, or let's say other setups.
A classical shared storage setup, you mean, like CSVs.
But maybe there is something there. You will test it. We will talk about it a little bit later. But no, let's really start with the showcast. And first, let's talk about the setup.
So let's do that.
These are my four little data on S2D systems. So I like them a lot. And this is even a setup that is really built for S2D. You see it at the name. The node's name is the box name is S2D and then the number. So these are 1U S2D systems with the possibility to put some NVMEs in there and SSDs and, of course, HDDs. So let's first talk about the hardware. So I have four data on S2D 3110 systems. Each system has two Intel. I think they are E5-2620 8-core CPUs. So the system has 16 cores. Okay. I have a lot of RAM in there. Each system has 320 gigabytes of RAM because we use these systems in our S2D power course training that we do here in my company, and I need a lot of RAM for that. But more important for our tests is the storage, and every system has two small 400 gig Intel P3700 NVMEs, and you don't get those anymore. Maybe you get some spares somewhere, but they are not on the market anymore. Intel has the next generation. It's called P4000 something. And also the SSDs are now with a 4. But I like this setup a lot. I have four 800 gig Intel SSDs, and it's the same flash than the NVMEs. So they have a DVPD of 10. Very nice stuff. And I have two 1.6 terabyte read optimized Intel SSDs in there. So this is a setup where I have NVMEs for tiering, SSDs, the good ones for the performance tier, and the read optimized SSDs as a capacity tier. And we have to say, this is not a supported setup because I have two different types of SSDs in my deployment. Yeah. When we would have HDDs, the HDDs would be the capacity tier, the SSDs would be the performance tier, but mm-hmm. I wanted to have an all-flash system, so I told the systems that these 1.6 terabyte SSDs are HDDs. Otherwise, yeah. it would not do the tiering correctly. So to be crystal clear, this is a demo system, a test system for us. It's not a production system, and this is not a supported scenario. Yeah, to be clear?
Yeah. Very, very clear. And also, perhaps, there's only one or two capacity disks in each node. So in normal situations where this would be HDD, you would have more.
Yes. But you
so it is a lab setup. It's for showcasing, experimenting.
Yeah.
So you have, unless somebody wants to drop a couple of hundred K in our way to build a realistic setup. I mean,
I could do normal disks in there, but I like the performance of the SSDs.
It's fine and it's great. I really like to see companies that make the investment to have a lab and test out scenarios that they can really destroy, rebuild, test different configuration. That makes a difference in the field if you have to deploy it, support it.
Yeah.
The expertise and the knowledge is gained by doing. Right?
Yeah,
that's basically.
Yeah, you're right. If you really want to do that stuff, and we implement a lot of S2D in Germany, and I was even in other countries to implement the stuff. You can't do it only by learning on the job at a customer. So you have to play with the stuff, and if you only play with it in virtualization, so you can do it in nested virtualization. You know that I talked about that already. I do that a lot also. But you have to get your hands on the stuff and play with it. Otherwise,
But that's the same for any technology that in real life still relies on hardware.
Yeah, that's
true. I mean, you cannot have the real experience of all the issues you might run into with firmware drivers, versions of NICs or vendor brands. You just have to trust but verify, and if you do everything virtualized, that's an abstraction level you put in there that takes away all that stuff.
Yeah,
and then you might make some assumptions that you can't always rely on in real life. Basically.
That's true, but better to do it virtualized than not.
That's for sure.
So in every system, the system are small ones, so I can add two more devices here. Yeah, because they are filled up and they have only two slots. To be honest, I had a problem that I had first two of those systems, and they were with two 400 gig NVMEs, and they were put in these slots here, so 2.5 inch NVMEs. But then I got two more systems, and the P3700 was not available on the market anymore with a 2.5 within a 2.5 inch form factor. So I bought four 400 gig P3700 NVMe PCI cards.
Okay.
So the slot zero is not zero is filled, one not, and I have a card in the back. So a 400 gig NVMe card. Yeah. It works. It's maybe also not supported because we have different. It's in essence, it's the same NVMe from Intel, but it has a different form factor. So one go on.
So the one is in truly in your PCI slot directly on the motherboard.
Yeah.
And the other one is in your disk bay in your hot swappable.
And then now the problem with the One U system is you have only two slots. So I have only one slot left for networking, and there I have a two-port 25 gigabit RDMA card, and they will be exchanged very soon for two-port 50 gig cards, but I have to do SET in this setup. And I know Microsoft loves the SET Hyper-V switch. I'm still more tending to the separate design. So you have RDMA NICs separately, and you have your Hyper-V switch separately.
Well, if you can, that's a really nice setup.
Yeah.
I mean, you get the best of both worlds. If you do your Hyper-V switch with SET, then you can do your software-defined networking version 2, generation 2, if you want to.
Yeah.
You can have all the goodies, but you don't have to.
Yeah.
But if you keep your RDMA out there, you know, I like Converged. I have always loved the promise of Converged, but in reality, we also have to face the fact that it's complex technology on top of complex technology, and if something goes wrong, it goes wrong for everything.
And it's very new.
But I've tested it. I experimented with it. I've blogged about it. How to set it up. How to create it from an existing situation and to go back. So it's not that we don't know it, and not that we don't like it, but for me, Converged is not a goal. It's a means to an end. And in this case, it is truly a means to an end, because in such a situation, you only have two ports. So basically, you're going to have to do SET or Converged networking to make it work. So that's a very good use case for using SET, even if you don't want to go beyond what SET can do for you on other levels, let's say with network virtualization, software-defined networks, and stuff like that. Yeah.
So to be honest, I have these two nice 25 gigabit RDMA cards. But this, you see the back here of a Cisco switch, it's a 10 gig Cisco switch. So we are running the 25 gigabit ports in a 10 gigabit switch. And that's a nice thing with the 25 gigabit ports. They are downwards compatible with the 10 gigabit ports. But you always hear me in my webinars, for example, talking about if you have NVMEs in your system, you should have more than 2 times 10 gigabits. And we will come there. We got two nice Mellanox SN2100 100 gigabit switches. I have two
Great,
of them.
Nice.
And
nice.
You can put, I invested in, because we always talk about RDMA and the faster stuff, but if you don't have it,
You haven't. You just created a very expensive
lab.
Bottleneck generator.
Yes, exactly. So this will be exchanged soon, but I have to wait a little bit. Then we have on the systems, we have a Windows Server 2016 RS1, also called RTM, Data Center Edition with a full GUI. I've not installed the Insider Preview builds because there are new features there. But it's only available in the Core Edition, and we will go on to the systems and show a lot. So maybe we'll look at the Core Edition a little bit later. So
you want something that's in support right now to the demo. That's also nice. Yeah.
Yeah, for a demo system you can go with Insider Build, but So the estimate costs for the hardware without Windows Server is a little bit below 50,000 euros.
So that includes the switches and stuff like that?
No, without the switches. So I would say with 60,000, 65,000, you would have the setup with the 100 gig switches, two of them. But I want to say this hardware without the switches, maybe you have 10 gigabit switches, is around 50,000, and if it's a demo environment, you have the possibility to download the Windows Server 2016 Data Center Eval Edition, because it's not production. Okay, let's go on, because we have a lot of cover and we are already talking for 15 minutes, I assume, or 10 at least. So this was the explanation of the test system. I now switch the screen to one of those. And if you look here are the four data. They are called DA on S2D1 to 4, and I'm on the first one. So if I open the server manager, we can have a short look at the hardware and the network layout, at least to add that. Here we have, you see here, the vEthernet SMB1 and SMB2. Yeah. We called about the SAT Hyper-V switch. So we have two RDMA virtual network adapters. And I have my VMs have the possibility to also use the same adapters, right? Mm-hmm. And then I have two 1 gigabit NICs for my management team. And I can open the network. Show you that. So we have two 1 gigabit NICs, Then we have a normal team, the management team. Then I have the two Manalnox cards here that are the real cards. And we have an SMB1 and an SMB2 virtual NIC. And you see two more NICs here. This is a NAT switch. I use that for my nested Azure Stack deployment. So you have a NAT switch there. It's not important for our setup. And we have an internal network. And this is important for the VM fleet. I will explain that a little bit later. But we need an internal network. And it is created if you set up VM fleet. It will create on every host an internal network. And it is used for the test VMs that we build later or that we look at to communicate with the system. The nice thing with VMFleet is you can change the test setup on the fly. So while you're testing, you can say, oh, I want to test another pattern. And the VMs, the test VMs, will very fast pick up the pattern. And to do that, they need a communication way from the VM to somewhere where the configuration is stored. And for that, the internal network is used. But we will look at that a little bit later. So this is my setup. I have I still like to separate the SMB networks in separate nets, so subnets. I still do that. I'm not a fan of putting all the NICs in the same network. But we can discuss that a little bit later. So let's talk about VMFleet. There are some prerequisites for that. So let's look at our failover cluster. You have to have a cluster of your hyper on your hyperconverged network. Here we are. It's called Daon cluster in this example.
For some reason, right?
So and we have to give VMFleet so that it can work as a fixed design, as a fixed virtual disk design. So we have to have one virtual disk that is that's name is collect. In that virtual disk, it has not to be big. You can go with 100 gig or half a terabyte. That's enough. It depends on what you are doing. But this disk is used to store VMFleet, all the scripts, to store if you do a sweep, a VMFleet sweep, it will store the results of the sweeps in a special directory in the collect disk and so on. So you have to have a collect disk. And then it depends on how many nodes you have in your S2D deployment. If you have a 4-node deployment, you have to have 4 virtual disks with the name of the node. So in my example, the node's name is DA on S2D1 to S2D4. So I have 4 virtual disks. If you have a 2-node S2D cluster, you would have 2 virtual disks here. If you have a 16-node S2D cluster, you would have 16 disks here.
And so for the record, this is a requirement for VMFleet. If you have S2D in production, it's okay to have preferably an even number of virtual of disks. You can have 2 per node. This is the disks being equal to the number of nodes is specifically now for VMFleet.
It's for VMFleet. We are just talking about the prerequisites for VMFleet. Of course, if you do a production deployment, you can change that. But because I do a lot of VMFleet, I name them like the nodes, and it's not bad to have that naming convention. But it doesn't really matter. So you see here, the disks are nicely aligned to the node. So the Daon S2D1 disk is the owner of the disk is the node. Daon S2D1 and so on. So you see it here. And the collect disk, it doesn't matter which node is the owner of this disk. Okay? So here are my nodes. We have an external witness. You see that because every node has a vote. Yeah? Otherwise, one node wouldn't have a vote. Sorry. So that's nice. And I deployed already 25 virtual machines that run the fleet tests. So we will first show how VMFleet is working and what you can do with it. And then if we show the benchmarks and the results, I will destroy the setup and start a fresh one with downloading everything you need. But to deploy 25 VMs on every node, so in total 100 VMs, that takes two, depending on the performance of your systems, of course, but 2 to 4 hours. And
we don't want to boring.
Do such a long long show. So we decided first to show VMFleet when it's deployed and it's showing benchmarks and so on. And afterwards, we will set it up. Usually, you would first set it up and then you can test it, right? So we displayed the disk layout. We just showed you the VMs here. So if I scroll down, you see we have 100 roles here. And I scroll down here, we have 25 roles on the first node. Yeah, you see here, the owner is the first node. Then we have 25 for the second node, 25 for the third node, and 25 for the fourth node.
Yeah?
Okay, we did that. So let's start one of those. No, first, let's start our VM fleet. So let's get another PowerShell. VMFleet, I told you, is collection of PowerShell scripts. We will navigate there. Let's go there. Cluster storage. Here you see in cluster storage, another requisite, we have to name our volume. So if you have a CSV, a cluster shared volume, there will be a link in the C under C cluster storage. And for VMFleet that it works, the link has to have the name of the virtual disks and not volume 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever. It has to be named like the virtual disk. So here we see the collect and the other volumes. The VMFleet is installed under collect, and I use the collect for a lot of more. So it will create a control directory under collect. And in the control directory, we see the scripts, the PowerShell scripts, and even a documentation here that belongs to the VMFleet. Yeah. So you see it here?
Okay. Yeah.
And it will also create three directories. I will explain the directories later when we deploy VMFleet fresh. So here are some helper scripts, and we can start, for example, the VMFleet with the start VMFleet command. So in this PowerShell, I change to the directory cluster storage collect control, and here I can type start VMFleet. If I do that, it will start all my VMs. I can also use, of course, the failover cluster, mark them, select them, and go on to the start button. But there is a script for that. So here now, they are not all running. Some are still off. Yeah, but they will be started. So
now nice little bootstorm.
Nice little bootstorm, right. So if I go into one of those, please show me the screen. Why don't you show me the screen?
Okay. It's core, man. This is the screen.
So I started the VM fleet, and the VM is a core installation of a Windows server, so it's small. And there has an auto login has been taken place. So you've seen that there is an auto login. We are now logged onto the system, and there is something running there. So you see it here. There is it's a disk speed with some parameters. So it's now doing the tests and I don't want that. It's now generating a lot of IO. We don't see that, but believe me, it's now in the background creating a lot of IO. So okay. The nice thing with VM Fleet is we have the possibility to pause, not the VMs, but pause the testing. So I can enter here, set pause via PowerShell. You see here, pause set, the little red one here. And in our VM, you see, oh, I have to pause the IO. Stopping current, reason pause set. So now I have still 100 VMs running, but they don't create a lot of IO. There is no speed test running. Okay. So this is the nice thing with VM Fleet. You have, when you deployed your test VMs, you can communicate with the VMs and tell them what to do. What are the tests? You can pause the test. You can start the tests. Yeah. So now let's see. We have opened one of the VMs. We can see here what's going on there. We have some scripts that will show us how many IOs, how many megabytes are going on in our cluster. There's another script called watch cluster. Not as such, it's watch cluster. And if you start this,
there we go.
You get a set display. There are more possibilities, and we will do that very fast. But if you only start it without any parameters, you see what's going on in my cluster shared volume file systems. So what IO is generated here? And we see in the moment we have 2,600 IOPS, IOs with the system. 1.7 thousand are read IOPS, and we have 400 write IOPS. So this is the IO that's done there per second. But you don't know how big are they. We don't know if are they 512 byte IOs or are they 1 megabyte IOs. And to really see what's happening there, it's also important to see the storage bandwidth. So this is the bandwidth we are transferring into and out of the system to VMs, 13 megabytes per second. So that's not very impressive, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But if we start up VM Fleet, if we kill the pause here, we will see that the tests pick up very soon. So I do here a clear pause. At least I hope I'm in the wrong directory. The nice thing, everything starts with a C, so you can type C, tab, C, tab, C, tab, and you are in the control directory. So now clear pause. You will see immediately something happened here. It has loaded a script and is now doing a disk speed. And you see here the numbers, maybe we can increase the numbers a bit. Layout, no, go to the font. Let's do a 14. Yeah, we have now 1 million. Hey, 1 million IOPS here in my system, and these are 1 million read IOPS. And
that's not too shabby, my friend.
That's really not shabby, but let it.
That's nice.
Yeah, that's nice, but who cares about read IOPS? This is not a real test scenario if you test read IOPS. Who
Could
has
be a streamers?
Yeah, of course. If you are Netflix, this would be the setup for you. You stream data, you only read it from disk and stream it to the people on the internet. So that's then you would be happy about this scenario. Maybe not, because you need more IOPS, but we have barely no write IOPS here. And to be fair, Microsoft, if they talk about millions of IOPS in Storage Spaces Direct, I think they usually do 100% read.
Sure. But let's face it. It doesn't matter whether it's Microsoft with S2D or other vendors. Everybody in the storage world, especially on the sales side, they talk about IOPS without any context. As long as the number is big, they don't care about latency, they don't care about the bandwidth, they don't care about the I/O size, they just want to show good numbers.
And
everybody plays that game. So you have to take all those claims with a grain of salt. On the other hand, of course, having really good base numbers means that even under more realistic, more stressy situations, the numbers should be adequate as well. And just keep it in mind that nothing is stopping you from generating workloads that are a bit more tweaked to what you will see in real life.
You're so right, my friend. So you just thought, while you were explaining about how the industry works, something happened here on the screen. The AI ops broke down to 70,000 or something. And here you saw that the VMfleet was loading something. So the nice thing with VMfleet is here, the tests are only, here are the numbers for that. So this test is running 60 seconds with a warm-up phase of 10 seconds and a cool-down phase of 10 seconds. So every 80 seconds, if you sum up the seconds here, it will reload. It will be finished, and then the script will reload another test script, and it's the same one. So I don't know, if we look here in the next 80 seconds, it should be reload. But first, let's talk a bit about the numbers. We have our nearly a million IOPS, no write IOPS. Here is the bandwidth. So how many IO is done with the storage system? And this is, of course, read, because we only do a read test. So you see, this is the sum of the reads and writes. And here you see the read IOs on the different systems and the writes. And a very important information is the latency of the system. So here it just happens. It was reading it again. The IO is going down, will come up again. Because all 100 VMs were started at nearly the same time, so maybe with a spread of 5 to 10 seconds. So they are all doing the same in the moment. So the IO is going down and coming up again.
And not an important here, perhaps for the American viewers, we are in Europe, so the decimal denominator there is a dot.
Yeah.
And that you look at those numbers correctly, right? Yeah.
So let's talk about the latency. You can get great numbers, but if your latency is over 20 milliseconds, for example, you have really an impact in your application, or 50 milliseconds, put it what you want. So here, this is very nice. We have a read latency of 0.3 milliseconds, and the write latency, there are some writes going on, of 1.5 milliseconds, 1.7 or so. So that is nice. Yeah. Here you see in this script, you can see what it is doing. So disk speed has a lot of options here. And you see here we have a $B variable. That's a 4. And if you look into this line here, this is, we do a 4K test. And this is random with 4K. So there is no offset as far as I know. Then we have disk speed doing 8 threads, so 8 parallel I/O threads, and every thread has 20 outstanding I/O. So this test will not wait for, it will not write one I/O and wait for that the I/O is coming back and then write another one. It gives up to 20 in a queue, and then it waits for the returning of one. At least that's my understanding. I don't know, Didier, have you?
So basically, you're queuing your IOs. And your threads are potentially here tweaked to the number of cores you have. I thought there were 8 core CPUs, so now you have 8 threads. So
to be honest, this is a standard test we are doing now.
Okay.
It's the default test Microsoft is doing, and there is another zero here. So this is the write part in percent. So we have 0%. Write, so that means we have 100% read,
and the reads are sequential. It's not random reads.
No, I think that's random.
Okay,
but I think it's random. I'm quite sure, but we can always be wrong,
it's,
right?
It says random read in the text, yeah, a little bit higher, so yeah. I guess it's random. Yeah.
So first, let's give some more informations out of the watch cluster. So most PowerShell scripts have additional parameters. So you can give the sample interval, and the next parameter is the sets. So this was one set called CSVFS, and you can specify the different sets, or you can specify show me all sets. And we will do that. So now we have much more information here. Yeah. So yeah. The first line was, or the first set was about the cluster shared volume file system. And we have a lot of going on there, right? Then we have four more sets. There is the SSB cache. It's a software storage bus cache. And this gives us information of the usage of our caching devices. Yeah. So there is not much going on here. We will see much more numbers here in different tests. But we see it's not really hitting the cache because we read from SSDs. If you do storage bases direct designs, you have to know if you have NVMEs in front of SSDs. The NVMEs are only used as a write cache because the SSDs are for read. They are fast enough. So we use all the NVMEs as a write cache and directly read from the SSDs. Yeah. So, and we do a read test. So nothing is in the cache here. Yeah. These remaps are for the bit writes we are doing here. So you see a little bit coming out of the cache, but it's our writes. And if you have a deployment with HDDs and NVMEs or HDDs and SSDs, so the SSDs would be the cache. With HDDs, the cache is used for read and write. You would see different numbers here, of course. So the next set is SBL. It's called the software bus layer. It's the layer that connects our four systems. I also call it east-west traffic, where we see a lot of I/O here. It's read from the software bus layer, but the VMs are running on the same host. So they are usually can read from the same host. And we don't write a lot through the software bus layer. But if you look at the numbers here, these are our write IOs, and we have much larger write IOs here. That's because if we write on one system and we have a three-way mirror, for example, or a double parity, these are the two things I'm running here. So the read optimized SSDs are in a double parity setup, and the fast SSDs, the performance tier, is in a three-way mirror. So if we write something in the SSD tier, the performance tier, we have to write it to two more systems, or maybe to three systems that are not, and the system the VM is running on is not part of these three systems because we have four nodes.
So which is possible.
Yeah. Yeah. So we have much more write here than here in this layer. And then we have the bandwidth here. So it's in essence, in the moment, it's the same than in the CSV layer. But if we get more writes and we have multiple writes to multiple systems, this bandwidth will increase. Yeah? Yep. Then the last set is how much CPU we have used on the systems. And you see here, 97%. So our VMs are now maxing out the CPUs. Yeah, if I open Task Manager here, and with 2016, that's very nice. You also see now what's happening in the VM. So you not only see the CPU usage of the management partition or the management OS, you now also see the usage in the VMs. You see here, my cores are maxed out.
That's obvious. Yeah.
It says 100% here, and you see it in the picture.
So do you think moving to 50 later on will make a huge difference?
I don't think so. Don't think so, because this test is maxing out my systems. If we go down with the test, so a real-world test would be not stressing the system to the limits, doing maybe 100 VMs, doing 500 IOPS or so. You can do that with disk speed. That would be something that is more like your workload you have in production. But of course, you want to test what are the limits of my system. And you see here, I'm at the limit.
So makes sense.
Let's come to the last set. It's a sum up of different things. So here we have this package is a CSV megabytes, and it should have the same numbers that here, this package. Yeah. If you look at it, 3,700, we have the same numbers here. The next one is the megabytes of the software bus layer, and this is the same numbers that we have here. Yeah.
Okay.
Then we have the disk megabytes. We don't have those numbers, so this is a new one. Yeah. And then we have the cache megabytes. This is here. Yeah, in the software storage bus layer. So this is how much data is going into the system, into the different layers. Okay?
Okay. Yep. Makes sense.
So there is much more data in this view than in the standard view. We would only see this one, right? Okay. So this is, we are now running 100% read, 0% write, 4K, a lot of outstanding IOs. And now I can do my own testing. I can tweak the tests. So let's explain how to do that. So to do that, we open an editor, and I like to edit PowerShell scripts. I like the PowerShell ISE, Integrated Script Environment, a lot. It's huge. We don't need it so huge. So let's only see the editing part. We will not execute something. And now we change to cluster storage collect control where our scripts are. And here are some run scripts. So the VM fleet scripting environment will load the newest run script. And if you look at the date, see here, I modified the run demo 100R script, so 100% read script, and we are now executing this script. So let's take the script, edit it. Oh, that's wrong. This is exactly the script we are doing now, but let's tweak it. For example, let's do a 30% write, 4K IOs. Let's leave the threads and the parallel threads and the outstanding IOs, but increase the write portion of our test to 30%. Okay. And let's save this script under a different name. Let's call it run Hyper-V Amigos PS1. I don't have to enter the PS1, I assume. So if we look in, here we have it. It has the newest
timestamp.
Yeah, and our VM fleet just recognized, oh, something has changed. There is a newer source file. Here we have it. Let's take this file and copy it into the VMs. And I clicked in there. And now we see 4.8.20.30. So now we modified our test pattern. Now all 100 VMs will pick up this new run script and run it. And we see it here in our numbers. They are changing. The IOPS are going down rapidly. So we have now only 580,000 IOPS.
Only, he says.
4K IOPS. we have 400,000 of them are read IOPS and 160,000 are write IOPS. And here also in the bandwidth, you see we have now 2 gigabytes per second write and read in our system. And that's not too bad. And here you see the different numbers. So the write portion is smaller than the read portion. Actually, it's 30%. And here you see the latencies. So the
which is quite realistic. I mean,
I think 30% is something I use always for testing. I think it's realistic for most scenarios. So now you see our numbers change. We have a bigger write latency here, and the read latency is also going up. So we have 100 VMs really hitting onto the system with a heavy workload. No? And it's still going on. So if we look at the software bus layer, you have 200 to 300,000 more IOPS, and we have more write IO here than read IOPS, because the system has to write the data to the other systems.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. You see here, it's loading it again. So I usually don't do 4K tests. And now it's, you see here, we have very nice write latencies here. See it?
Oh, yes. I see them. Yeah.
So this, no, of course, we have one machine that is mean to us. S2D4.
There's always one.
There's always one. But when I was talking about it, when I was pointing it out, we had really nice numbers here. Now they are going up again. So remember, we are really testing the limits, and this is not something you should do in production. You will not have on those four nodes €50,000. Remember, this workload running. Yeah, but it's nice to test it. Okay. So let's tweak it again to a workload that's more what I always test. Yeah? I always do 8K tests. So when I can just tweak my file here, I save it, and you see immediately VMfleet picks up there's something changed and starts the new test. And that's I really love about VMfleet, because you can do so nice things
on
there.
On the fly changes.
On the fly, yeah.
Yeah.
Now you see we have bigger IOs, so our IOPS per second are going down, because there are 8K IOs now, they are double the size than the 4K IOs. Our bandwidth increases in the moment, but also our latencies are much higher. So we have to give the system a little bit of time to smooth everything out, and then we will see maybe a better write latency. Yeah, but this I usually test. Okay.
Okay.
So we have done the tests, and there are also possibilities to simulate some realistic workloads. We have to tweak something in this line here. So there is a possibility to limit disk speed, how many I/O it will generate. Yeah, I do that sometimes at customers. So let's simulate 100 VMs doing 500 IOPS, not hitting the system like crazy, but let's do 500 IOPS. That would be a nice, I think it is still a good performance test, because it's more at the higher end. If all your VMs in average would have 500 IOPS, that's not bad, right?
Those are hardworking VMs, let's put it that way.
But for that, we have to look at the documentation of disk speed. And we do that. Let's do a control C here. But where is disk speed? It's in the run. My friend, maybe you can also... This system is a little bit under stress, you see it.
Yeah. So you can go to C, right? C and then run.
Yeah. So if you do disk speed, I think minus help. No. There is an output somehow. Yes, there is it. Disk speed can do a lot of crazy things. And let's see. If we find it very fast. Otherwise, we have to cut it a little bit. So a line count enables sprinting. That's also nice. I do that sometimes. Disk speed can do a dot for every X IOs. So if you use disk speed, usually it runs for a while. It doesn't give you any feedback. And at the end, you get a statistic. So if you want to see what's happening, you can say, give me a dot or print a dot for every 10,000 IOPS or for every 1,000 IOPS. Yeah. Number of outstanding IO requests, no. Priority counts, number of IOs per burst. Total number of threads. Of course. I don't find it so fast, so milliseconds, no. You can limit it. That's a problem to just find it.
Let me...
No, I don't find it. Let's go on. We have a lot of to do. Maybe I will write it in the blog and that you look at the blog post for the command that you can do, because we are still in part two. I have a part three here, and maybe we add a part four.
Could also always place with storage cross policy if you want to.
You can do it with storage cross policies, of course, on the system, and one of our future showcasts will be about storage cross policies, because you can do a lot of nice things there. So to maybe give a short outlook, we can just show what's going on in the system. So we just go do a get storage cross flow. I like this a lot, because we don't do anything with storage cross policies. We just show what's going on here.
So and this is in the previews, you had to enable storage cross, but in RTM it's just there by default. It's on your cluster.
Yeah.
And basically, even without defining anything, you have the run of the mill standard default cross. That's the only policy that will be in there. But the nice thing is you can have your metrics about what your VAGXs are doing, and that's quite interesting.
Yeah, here you see these are the disks. Here's our VM yeah. Amigos. It's on the first node, the ninth VM, and it is doing 6,200 something IOPS per second in average over the last 5 minutes, right? And it's doing 50 megabytes read and write. So that's nice. There's another one. We only do a peek, and we do a whole series about that. I like the volume also a lot.
Yeah.
So the collect volume is doing nothing, but the others are doing 100,000 IOPS each.
Those are nice numbers.
Yeah. So you see here, nearly 900 megabytes per second in and out bandwidth. Very nice. And the latency is only on this volume with the less... It doesn't have the most IOPS, but it has the biggest latency. Something is not so well with this volume. But let's go back to our testing, because I wanted to show some other things that are important. The performance counters. So Perfmon is always your friend, and we didn't do that. So
the thing is, you have to understand your friend. That can be a bit tricky.
It's true. Yeah. And we will only show three performance counter. And by the way, how is this watch cluster working? It's a nice PowerShell script that remotely connects to the host and will grab the performance counter and sum them up and display them. So. Yep. That's a very nice piece of work, and it's very well done. So here you see now the auto lock-on going on, and then it will run the test. I shut down the VM and started again, and it will now join our 99 other workers and doing some work. Yeah. So these numbers, where are they coming from? It's from Performance Monitor. Our good old friend.
Undervalued friend,
exactly. So if you go to Performance Monitor, First, one thing we want to show is the RDMA activity.
Okay.
Because we use RDMA. You see here, I have four RDMA adapters. How is that? I have only two.
Sets, of course, yes. My dear friend. Sets.
So maybe you explain that.
Well, of course, set goes over hardware. So in your RDMA activity, you can see the physical NICs showing up there. But of course, you have your virtual NICs that do RDMA, and they have RDMA activity as well. So you'll see all of those, basically.
And you see that here in the moment. So we have two virtual NICs here and the two.
Yeah, and go figure. The numbers should match more or less, of course,
yes,
because it's basic. Yeah.
And they do really. So if you look here,
Do, and they will do even better if you map them, right? If you map the virtual.
I think I mapped them, and they should be the same. So, but this is only to show we have a lot of RDMA traffic. This is we don't do live migration in the moment, so you get higher numbers if you do live migration in parallel. But you see here, we have a lot of going on over RDMA, and this is our software storage bus writing the data to the other side and reading stuff and so on. Okay.
Yeah.
But to look in the system, what's happening there, I like one counter a lot. That is the storage spaces tier counters. And you only have them if you have a performance tier and a capacity tier. So this is if you use a multi-resilient volumes. And you can have three-way mirror in your performance tier and three-way mirror in your capacity tier. You have these volumes, but you don't have these numbers if you only have one type of disk and you don't do virtual disks with multiple tiers.
Yep.
Yeah. I think we did that already in our storage spaces for backup showcase,
right? I think so, yeah.
So here you see in the moment, this is the one disk that is where this host, the day on S2D1, is owner of. He is owner of this disk. And we see the performance tier, that's the SSD part, what's going on there. And the capacity tier, this is the HDD. The HDDs that are the read optimized SSDs. And we see here, we have 800 megabyte of transfer read and write to this performance tier, the SSD part, and this is the double parity tier, the capacity tier. We have 180 megabytes of transfers there. It's all read. We are not writing into this tier because in the moment our SSD tier is not filled up. Maybe you remember, and if you don't remember, look at the showcase where we talked about storage spaces as a target for as a backup target. We were talking about that a lot. Only if this tier fills up to 60%, data will be moved to the HDDs, to the double parity. So the coldest data, the data that is not used much, is moved to this tier. And that's not happening in the moment, so we don't see write bytes here, and we don't have IOs here.
Yeah, that makes sense, yeah.
Yeah. This is because my test setup is too small. It fits in the performance tier. So we are, in the moment, mostly testing the performance tier with read and write.
So basically what you're telling us is beware, your tests have to be realistic enough not to give you a false impression.
Yeah, and we will talk about setting up tests that will really test your system, also the smallest, the slowest tier, later in part four. We are still in part two, okay? So let's get another counter. We will not explain the numbers there, but when you want to see what's happening with your cache. So we have NVMEs here as cache, and I have to find it. Let's see, cluster storage hybrid disk is the right one. Cluster storage hybrid disks, all instances. So these are a lot of lines, and you see here 1827, 3-8, 4-7, 5-8, and we talked about that, I think, also in this other thing. So this is, we have an NVMe, that's a caching device, that should be the 8 or the 7, the 8 or the 7, the 8 or the 7. And then we have a capacity device, the 1, the 2, the 3, the 4, the 5, and the 6. You remember we have two NVMEs, it's disk 7 and disk 8. And then we have four SSDs, fast ones, and two SSDs, slower ones. So these are the capacity devices, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
And six. Makes sense.
And here you see what's happening between caching and capacity device. So how is the NVMe, for example, use the NVMe with the disk number 7 to the capacity device with the disk number 2? You see here, there's something going on, so there's caching happening. Yeah? And most of the caching should be in the read area. Where do we have the read area? Here are reads. We have disk reads. Disk reads per second, 90,000 IOPS. And in the write per second, this direct writes, disk writes per second. It's more. Of course, I'm wrong. I was thinking most should be happening in the read area, but more I/O is in the write area. Yeah, because we have only SSDs, and we are doing most of the stuff into the SSD tier, though the performance tier, though that's maybe the thing. Yeah. But let's just look at the numbers. Don't explain them too much. We have much more to show.
That's homework for the viewers.
Yes, it is. Please do your homework. So in performance, Pathmon is your friend. You can get a lot of information there. Okay. So this is, in essence, what we wanted to show. That one thing is left there. And it's like a mystery. So at least it was a mystery for me for a long time. So let's stop all the I/O. So this is the set pause. It's not something with stop, it's set pause. If you see, it should pick up the pause. Yeah, it's picking up the pause, and now our I/O is going down very fast.
That's over.
Yep. And now our VMs, they are still running, they're doing a little bit I/O, but they are not doing disk speed anymore. So there's one thing left. It's nice that we can do all these tests and look at the numbers, but if you want to have real statistics or real measures, you have to look at the screen and write down the numbers, and the numbers are quite changing a lot between the seconds. So what is the average? Is the average 500,000 IOPS with this test, or is the average 700,000 IOPS? You can only guess it. Yeah. So there's something else in VMFleet, and this is called sweep. So if we look at our directory, there is a start sweep. Where is it? Start sweep. And you can do sweeps of tests with that. So let's just type it without any option. It will ask you a lot of options. So, and I will increase the screen a bit. Yeah.
So now we're going to set the cluster size, the etc.
Exactly. We want to measure a lot of stuff. So the first thing is, we want to do different testing. So maybe we want to test a 4K test and an 8K test. Yeah. And you want to know the 64K data. Okay. I have now three different test sizes, 4K, 8K, 64K. If I don't enter something here the sweep script knows, so no more test sizes. So let's talk about threads. How many threads? One thread. Let's do something with four threads and something with eight threads. That's enough threads. how many outstanding IOs we want to do. Oh, let's try 4, 8, and 20. And how many write percentage do you want? Let's try 0, so all read. Let's try 20%. Let's try 50% write, and let's try 100% write.
Okay.
So
now we're talking.
Now we are talking. So let's take a calculator. Where's my calculator? Here it is. So how many?
I know.
How many tests we have? We have three sizes we want to test. Three of them, and three different threat numbers. So times three, and we want to have three different outstanding IOs times three, and we want to have four write percentages times four. So these are 108 different tests with 100 VMs. Yeah. So yeah. If I type enter here, if we'll start with the first, I think permutation is the right word. So 4K, one thread, four outstanding IOs, 0% read. And it should be here. 4K, duration is 60 seconds. Oh, outstanding IOs is 4. First number here. Duration is 60. Block size is 4. One thread, 0 write. It will now do the test in 100 VMs. And then it will take the next permutation. So maybe...
And so on. Yeah.
So it will do... How many was it?
108
tests with 100 VMs, and that's nice, but where is the results? So the results will be saved in a directory called result. Nice, right? Let's have a look. There are no results yet, but we're
still running the first test.
The first test is over, we will get here 100 files. For each VM, we will get one XML file for these tests. So we will have 108 times 100 files here when all tests are done, and that will maybe take one day or 2 days. I don't know. We can estimate it. 60 seconds for each test. 108 cool down, start up. So let's say 2 minutes. One times 108, we will have 216 minutes. That should be 3 hours, right? Or did I do something?
A little bit more.
Yeah, maybe
60 minutes an hour, so.
Yeah, so 240 would be 4 hours.
It's about 4 hours, yeah.
So we can estimate it. At least 4 hours. I gave it 2 minutes for each test. So yeah. It is only doing 60 seconds and some... No, cool is 60, warm is 60.
Warm is 60.
So it's 3 minutes already.
It's 3 minutes, yeah.
Okay, so after 3 minutes, we will have some files here, and then it will do the next test, and the next test, and the next test. So, and now we will have 10,800 files. How do we get our data? And there
automation?
Yes, I don't have an answer for that. There is a nice script that is part of the disk speed suite. We will look at that a little bit later, but it doesn't sum up, it doesn't give you everything you want. We have 10,000 tests, and here are the average over 100 VMs and so on. I don't find that, but maybe there are some possibilities with BI, and this would be something nice for Azure to load up all the files and do some magic mathematic things there, and you get a nice overview. And if one of our viewers has an idea there or has even a solution there, it would be more than welcome to get it, because if you do those tests, it's a lot of XML files, and we will peek in one of those later. So it's hard to look into 10,000 of them. So you see now, done. He's done now. It should be 3 minutes. And there our result files are magically appearing.
Yeah, that was one test. There we go.
That was one test. 107 to go. So we can open one. We don't have to wait. So I used a Notepad. You can use an XML viewer, of course. XML is nicely to interpret. How you call it?
To interpret.
Interpret. Thank you very much, my friend.
It's, well, let's say let's let's say it's human readable, but it's not always human parsable.
It's much more parsable with an automate also. So yeah. You see the percentiles here. It's very nice. The read milliseconds or total milliseconds. So this speed can throw a lot of nice statistics, and this is even going on. Yeah. So this is one test. Very nice. So very nice stuff. Okay, I will kill this because we don't want to wait for 4 hours. And I think we have done everything we wanted to show in benchmarking.
Yeah.
Yeah. The VMs, I will shut down the VMs. Here you see they are still doing the IOs for the next test. It's a lot of read. It's basically a read only test. So nice. So I will shut down the VMs. There are two possibilities. You can use the stop VM fleet script, but I learned it's much faster to use the cluster. Do Control A and say shutdown. So in the next part, in part three of this showcast, we will show you the setup of VM fleet. And to do that, we have to first kill the VM fleet we are just looking at.
Oh, so, no.
Yes, of course. So we have to kill the 100 VM fleets that are in the cluster here.
Don't do this to your production cluster.
Yeah, if it's VM fleet, you can do it. So we remove the roles from the cluster. It's very easy. Take some time, 100 of those. And then we have to kill the VMs. So yeah, here so I have Hyper-V Manager opened.
You see can't here, delete them.
There's something else on the system, so I can't do a Control A. Go to
and of course, the files still do exist.
Exactly. We have also to delete them on the storage.
So if you do this a lot, you can automate this in PowerShell. So
yeah, but it's not so hard to do it by hand.
No, and it's gives us something to look at while we explain what we're doing.
So the third node, this is the fourth one. So they are gone here. Okay, so now we have to clean the disk. Here we have an old setup. You see here CR1. That's a nice thing. When we create VM fleet, we can give a group name. And this group was with Amigos. I had another group with CR1. If you don't give a group name, there's a default. So let's remove those. It takes a bit, but the system is fast.
There we go.
And
that's how easy you destroy a couple of hundreds of VMs.
No, it was a couple of hundreds, maybe. It was not a couple of hundreds, it's 180.
And now for a backup restore demo, if you've taken the wrong ones.
So this is a demo environment. We don't backup this one.
Backup is for cowards, right?
It's just demo and playing around, right? Yep. Learning, in essence.
Absolutely.
Some Azure Stack deployment there, but the nice thing is if the VM is still in Hyper-V registered, you can't delete it. So it will not delete this stuff. It can help here if it says, oh, this is locked, I can't delete it also. Okay, I think we have cleaned up nicely. Yes, this is all stuff I need. maybe for tomorrow. Tomorrow I have
Class?
two webinars, and there I need some stuff. So, and the control directory, we also kill the control directory because I really want to show you
how to set it up.
Yeah, so we have to go out of the control directory. And there was another PowerShell in the control directory. I think it will not care, but it wouldn't be fair. So I will kill the control directory. Go away, my friend. So now we cleaned up the machine. And now we have to download VMfleet. So I have an empty VMfleet directory here. But first, before we do that, let's start to create. Let's talk about the requirements for VMfleet. One requirement is the disk layout we talked about earlier. You have to create a virtual disk per node. So we have that. And the collect virtual disk. If we look at cluster storage, we have this layout here. And the names have to be the same. So your disk has to have the name collect under cluster storage and the name of your host. We have that. Okay, that's requirement one. For VMfleet, we will deploy a lot of virtual machines. And for that, we need a disk, a VHD or a VHDX disk with an installed operating system in there. Yeah, so that VMfleet, when you create the 100 or 50 VMs, however, it can take this disk, copy it, do some magic around it, and you have your disk. It will not take an ISO and install from an ISO. So we have to create these.
Is it sysprepped or is it?
You don't have to sysprep it because it doesn't have really network. It is not part of a domain. Yeah. In essence, you won't sysprep it because we want to have an user in there. You can do. I think you can sysprep it, but it's not a requirement. Okay. So we have to create a VM, and we will do that. And another requirement, of course, is you have to have the VMfleet script. You have to set up the layout in the collect directory, and you have to have a test tool like disk speed. And VMfleet actually is designed for disk speed, so we also have the binary of disk speed. So first, let's create a VM. We do that in the Hyper-V manager. Let's do a new virtual machine. We call it V16 core template. I use the core, so the Windows Server Core Edition, because it's smaller and we have to copy 100 machines. So smaller is good, or create 100 machines out of a template. So we create this template a lot. And it's nice if you want to look in the machine, you see the test PowerShell script. You don't have the server manager popping up and so on. So I call it template. I will change the path where it's created. So we create it in collect VMs. Next, I do a generation 2 VM. I give it some memory. You don't need much because it's a core. We don't connect it to a network.
Just make sure you have sufficient memory for what you're choosing.
So now it's important, don't use the default 127 gigabytes, because when VMfleet copies the template, it will create a fixed disk of the maximum size of it. So if you create 100 VMfleet VMs, it will copy 100 times 127 gigabytes. So shrink it down to that you want to test. So the core edition maybe needs 6-7 gigabytes, and VMfleet, and you use the defaults, will create a 10 gigabyte test file. So 20 gigabytes would be enough.
Okay,
we'll do that. 20 gigabytes, and we want to install an operating system. So I have the EVOL version of the Windows Server 2016. You can also do it with 2012 R2, I assume, but I take the latest, greatest. So let's create this machine, and while it's installing, let's put a space here so it boots from the ISO image, from the DVD. So you can change to a German keyboard if you want to, or an Belgium keyboard, or an Australian, yes. Whatever you want. It's easier if you interrupt the PowerShell that's automatically running there. In Germany, we have a different keyboard layout, so I always have the wrong characters. So now we have the question, data center eval. I go with the standard core edition, so without the desktop experience. You only need standard. You can do a data center, of course. I accept the license. I use custom only. This disk, 20 gig.
Just say there, new one, and it will doodly out automatically. And it's a generation 2, so the install will be very fast.
Yes, it will. So let's do that. So now, how we get VMfleet? VMfleet is publicly available in the internet.
GitHub.
Yes. But if you don't know the GitHub path, I just search for it. So let's see how Bing is finding it. And here,
there we are.
We have to increase it a bit. The right one is, I was already with this Internet Explorer on the right one. This is a blog about VMfleet. That's nice. You can go there. But as Didier mentioned, it's on GitHub. And VMfleet is part of the source of DiskSpeed. DiskSpeed, the performance testing tool, it's available free in the internet with the source code. And they put VMfleet as a sub-project in DiskSpeed. So if you find GitHub, it's part of DiskSpeed. I browse there. And now, a little bit tricky, there is no download here. We are now in the VMfleet part. Here we could download now every PowerShell script, but there's an easier part. You go to DiskSpeed, to the root of the project.
Yep.
And then you here have the nice button clone or download. So you click on clone or download and download a zip file. And you get everything from DiskSpeed, including VMfleet. So let's say save as. We go to cluster storage, collect. VMfleet, it's an empty folder. We save it here. It should be very fast. We open the folder. I can't close the internet yet. We still need a DiskSpeed binary. We could now use the sources here with a compiler, create the newest binary. That would be nice. But I don't have a compiler on this system. So I have to look for DiskSpeed. Let's go back to Bing. I don't know why this machine is so slow in the moment. Hello. Hello, machine. What are you doing?
It's a Sunday afternoon.
Yeah, it's fantastic that it's Steven Bieber. There was a, you saw the picture?
I have a filter. I don't see that.
let's enter DiskSpeed here. There is DiskSpeed. Let's try this one. There's the last binary version, DiskSpeed. Version 2.0.17, it's a SIP. And it would be nice if someone would compile it and upload the newer version, because they improve disk speed a lot. But for our tests for VMfleet, we don't need a newer version. So I will save the disk speed SIP in the same directory. Well, that's enough with our Internet Explorer. We now have two SIPs here. So first, I will double-click on this SIP, and you see here there is a disk SIP master in it. I just take it and let it fall in the VMfleet directory. There are some files in it, takes a little bit. And I do the same with disk speed. Oh no, I don't do that. From disk speed, we only need one file, that's here. Yeah. So let's extract this to the VMfleet directory. So we now have the disk speed master directory and the disk speed and our two zip files. Okay. So first, if we go to disk speed master, we don't find VMfleet here. It's hidden in the framework. So you have to go to frameworks, and there is our VMfleet with all the scripts, the newest version. So I take this one and also move it to the VMfleet directory. And we can kill everything else now. We can kill the disk master.
And the two zip files, basically.
Yes. So we clean up a little bit. Okay. Coming back to our template, it's installed everything, and it is not the GUI version, so it doesn't ask us for a password in the GUI. We have to do it in this nice command. So I said I want to set the password for the administrator. So I use a very easy password. It's a version of password. I changed it, and now I have to log in. This is very important. You have to log in once to your template so that the environment for the administrator is built. The directory with desktop and so on. Desktop is maybe not there, but download user files and so on. And now we are finished with our template. We logged in as an administrator. We gave it a password for administrator. So now we can shut it down. We have now prepared our VHDX we use for creating our VMfleet machines. So here we use this PowerShell command, or this PowerShell, yes, this PowerShell window, and go to C cluster storage. Then we have our
VMfleet collect first.
Yeah, I missed the collect, and then we need the VMfleet. So this is the directory with our VMfleet directory and the disk speed. We go into VMfleet, and here we have all the PowerShell scripts. And to install VMfleet, to copy VMfleet to the right places, to get the disk layout. So we need under collect, we need a control and three more directories. You remember the result directories was one, and then we have a flag and a tools directory. To get this layout, there is even a script there. It's called install VMfleet, and it wants to know the only option you have is the source. You have to set where is the VMfleet, and for that you have to take the whole path. Yeah. So now we are there. I type enter, and now it will create the control directory under cluster storage. Here's control, and it creates the three subdirectories, and it copies the PowerShell scripts and the documentation to this path, and it sets the parser. So it should be in flex, parser is set. There is a file here that's called parser. So we have now nearly everything on the right place. There's one thing missing. We need a test tool. And every virtual machine has to have disk speed in it, a binary version of disk speed. So if you want to have something in the virtual machines, you just put it in the tools subdirectory. So when it creates a virtual machine, it copies everything that's in the tools subdirectory into every virtual machine that it creates. So we could even copy the IO meter in every virtual machine if you want to. We can put our two files, IO meter and the DynamoExe and the config files also here, and we would have also IO meter in every VM. There's one more thing we have to do. There is a DLL missing in the Windows subdirectory. but then IOMeter can run in the core edition. So now we prepared everything. We have our control directory. We have our scripts here. And now I change to cluster collect control. Here we are. And tools is our disk speed. We have our scripts here. So to create VM fleet, to create our VMs, there is a create-VM-fleet PowerShell command.
That PowerShell will use command. Our template.
Exactly. So we have to do some magic here, create VM fleets. Minus tab. It has some parameters we have to give it. So one is, what is the base VHDX that I should copy? You can now copy, you can type the path, but one easier thing is, of course, to get
the template and copy it. Yeah.
Yeah, we just created our VM and the VMs, core template, hard disk. Here we have it. If you hold down the shift key and do a right click on this file, you can use copy as path. Now we have the path in the clipboard. And if I do a right click here, it copies the path to the command line. So next we have VMs. It's wrapping here, so it wants to know how many VMs we want to deploy. I will not enter 15 here or 25. I only do one. Why is that?
Otherwise, we're going to sit here for a couple of hours looking at create VM fleet running, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And we have to.
Which is nice. But.
Yeah, it's nice, but it's boring after a time. And we have to give some passwords. So VMFleet will create the VM. It will configure an auto login into the VM with the credentials I will give it to him. And it will create a connection from the VM running on the host to the file system. So it will map the file system into the VM under the L drive letter. And for that, it has to use credentials. And if I type the credentials not correctly and create 25 VMs on each host, after 3 hours, I will start the VM and can't log in. So and then I have to delete everyone. So I only create one on each host, test if it's right, and then I will create the other ones. Okay, so I makes always sense. Do only one. Now I have to get the groups. Groups, if we want to give it a special name for
example, Amigos, right?
Yeah, the Amigos would be Amigos. So now you can create different sets. Yeah? Then it wants to have some credentials. Admin password of the VM. So I have to type the password here. And this was the password I used for the administrator account in the VM. And it wants to know the admin of the VM. It's the administrator. And now it wants to use the connect password so the VM can connect to the host and map the drive. So this is the same one. No, it's a different one. Okay, I messed up the password. So it's good to test this and it needs a connect user. Admin is, oh, and now you can, you know why you should test it. Administrator. So now you have stop after. It can stop, it can specialize. There are some more options here, but we don't do that. This is enough. So now it will create 4 VMs on each node. It will do another thing. It will create a Hyper-V switch that is called internal. And I have this switch already, so it's not doing that. But if you start it the first time, I have to go to Hyper-V switches. It will create an internal switch. Yep. So the advantage of an internal switch is, if you compare it with a private switch, the internal switch, also the host where the VMs are running on, has an interface in this internal switch. So it will, every VM that is created is connected to this internal switch later, and the host has also is also part of this network, and it will create an internal switch, and the script will also give the vEthernet adapter on the host a special IP address. So you see here the vEthernet adapter. Every Ethernet adapter on every four nodes has the IP address 169.254.1.1. These are special addresses. These are the APIPA addresses. Mm-hmm. They are called that way. So if a host is configured to use DHCP, but it doesn't find a DHCP server, it will give itself an address of this space, a random address in this space. So every VM, we don't have a DHCP server on this internal network, and we don't have to. Every VM will get an address in this address range. And if our host is part of the same address range, the VM can communicate to the host with this address. And all our hosts have the same address. So when the VM later does a map to /169.254.1.1/C$\cluster-storage\collect, yeah, we will have a drive that is pointing to our VM fleet directory.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a trick they do. And this is the reason why VM fleet is not running in a converged scenario. Because then you can't use an internal adapter from the Hyper-V host, because your storage is on another host and you have to really use a real network and you have to manage somehow the addresses. So you have to set up a DHCP server and you have to modify the script so that they have different IP addresses, they use DHCP and so on. So this was fast. This is the nice thing. If you have an all-flash deployment, the four VMs are already created. If we look now in the failover cluster, we have our four VMs. So now we connect to one of those, and I assume I've done something wrong with the passwords, but let's see. We start one of those. You will see the boot. So first thing, I got it wrong with the auto login. So it is not auto login to the host.
So my is kind of a bummer if you do it for all your VMs, right?
Exactly. So we would wait 3 hours and then we see, 100 VMs can't log in. So I can turn this off. I can say, please do two of them. So this is now a little bit of a trick. If I say two, and I will correct the password because I assume I used the upper letter W here. It will see, one of every name is already created. You see it here. It will name the VMs like VM dash our group name dash the host it's running on, and then a number from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So now it creates two on each host, and I can delete the first one now because I have some time now. I can delete the roles here. I can go to Hyper-V Manager because this will not work. I can create this one. It's the first one. Delete. Yes. So clean up a bit. Delete. Yes. Delete. Delete. Why are the others not showing up yet? Because first he's copying the disk and then he will create with the disk. He will auto mount it, set the auto login, unmount it, and then create the VM. So first copy the disk, then how you say it?
Create the VM. Yeah,
create the VM. Do some magic with it, initialize it, and then create the VM. So and then the VM will show up here. So we are now, we have downloaded it, we have the disk speed, we have our template created, we are deploying another four of the VMs. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So if this works, so we have to wait now for the next VM. If this works, we can change our command line and say, so I don't want two of those, I want 25. And then it will look, the first one, it's not there. I still forgot something. I've still to delete the disk.
The files?
Yeah. From this one. I can delete because it's not in Hyper-V anymore. So you see here the other directories. It already copied the stuff. It's nearly done. That's so nice if you have SSDs. It will take a little bit longer, but it's still fast if you have HDDs. You see here. So now we have our next bunch of disks. Do the same again. We start one, connect, start.
So now we should see that auto login works. At least I hope.
Me too. Auto login is working. So now the part of the connection to the host. You will get errors there, usually. Usually you should see something red here. Yes, no. This red is normal. But if it says two or three times I can't connect, that's not a problem. Yeah. But in the end, if there is a pause in force, so now I can do, if this runs, I can do, let's do three of them. Yeah, you see the script, you get the hang of it. If I change this to three, I want three on each host, it still says one is not there. It creates the one, then it will see the second one is already there. You get the green output and it will create the third one. So that's always nice. So let's look into the VM. It pause is enforced. How can it do that? If we do a net use, you see we have the drive L is connected to
the host
C dollar. This is why we need an administrator account, a local administrator account. And I think it only works with administrator because Microsoft did something there. I tried to create an own administrator account with a different name and it doesn't work. Maybe there is a trick or I did something wrong, but I always use the local administrator. And for the video or for the showcast, I just changed the password. So we usually don't use a variation of password, but to use it in the video, I had to do that. So and then it automatically mounts a control directory. So if I do a dir, we see our scripts. And this is how the VMs get, if you change something, they have a path to the directory. They always look in the if there is something changing, and they then load the new script. They look for the run, if a new file with run is there, with a new timestamp, exactly, and it will load it. Okay, this sums up part three. How do we get VMfleet? How do we install VMfleet? How does it work that the VMs can connect to the system over the internal adapter? And now you see the VMs creating, so it will take an hour or 2 hours before we have our 25 ones. The three are fast, so it shouldn't take so long, and then you can play with VMfleet.
Okay.
So we are now at 1 hour and over 30 minutes. I will just go to part four and give you some tips that we learned while doing a lot of testing with VMfleet in production environments or in real environments for customers. So the first one was, of course, don't only test read. Read is a very nice benchmark, but if you use writes, you get a real test because your customers have writes. You have writes in your environment. So go on, Didier.
Yeah, I just want to say that don't get pinned on getting the maximum IOPS to show to your customer. Just make sure that your customer gets all the IOPS with a margin that he needs, really needs, and that's what you're aiming for. So it's nice to have really big numbers, but it doesn't really mean that much in real life.
Exactly. So then the next thing is, if you really want to test a system in production, it would be nice to not only test the flash. So in our scenario, I told you I have two NVMEs here. I have four 800 gig SSDs. This is the performance tier, and I have two 1.6 gigabyte read optimized SSDs. So substitute the read optimized SSDs with your HDDs. You want to know what's happening if I have filled up my system with data and the VMs are running, and of course data is also, or VMs, part of the VMs are also on the HDD part. Yeah. So you should also test the HDD part and not only your flash part. So to do that, you have to know some things. I already mentioned VMfleet uses a 10 gigabyte test file. So let's again go into the VM. And if you do, oh, this is a stupid one, do a dir in system 32. So if you go to the run directory and do a dir, you see disk speed. It's nice that someone is online. Disk speed creates a 10 gigabyte test file. So we had 100 VMs deployed, 25 VMs on each host. So if we have a 10 gigabyte test file in 25 VMs, we need 250 gigabytes, or we have a 250 gigabyte footprint on our virtual disk per node on the virtual disk. So if we look at the virtual disk, we can do it here. It's finished with the other VMs. So if we look here, all the VMs are there. So if we look at our virtual disks, we have 2.7 terabyte in each virtual disk. If we create test files with 250 megabytes, of course, we are only testing the performance tier, because there's no need to move data from the performance tier to the capacity tier. So there are two solutions to that problem. Didier, do you have any idea?
We could do the people with too much time and too much money approach and just create gigantic test files in our VMs.
Yeah.
Which is of course the most time consuming and potentially also the most expensive. The other way we could do it is just reduce the size of our flash tier to make sure that the tiering starts happening a lot sooner.
Exactly. So the two ways you can deploy a humongous amount of virtual machines with 10 gigabit. So, but that would be a lot of VMs, and they would not even be running because we don't have so much CPUs. Then you said we can increase our test file. That's perfectly correct, and I will show you where you can do that. And the other way I prefer is to reduce the disks or reduce the flash part of our disks. So if we then fill up the disks, and the flash is filled up, we have to move to our HDDs. So first I show you where you can change. It's not the right one, it's control. So in the create VMfleet script, there's also a part. Increase it a bit. If you search here for 10 gig or for 10, you see that the test file is created while the create VMfleet takes place. Yeah, and here you have the fixed amount of 10 gigabit. So gigabyte, sorry. So if you want to have a 100 gigabyte file, you change these two numbers, and then you of course have to create a larger disk when you create your template.
So larger VM.
Yeah, a larger VM, a virtual disk. So you would maybe go with the 127 gigabytes.
Yeah.
So this is that you can do, but it takes longer to deploy them because it will copy 100 plus the operating system. Yeah. So 110 gigabytes each time you deploy a VM.
And if you're building huge SSD environments, you have to scale this up all the time, and it becomes too time consuming.
Yeah, that's right. So the other way is you don't create your virtual disk that you use all your space. You create much smaller virtual disk or virtual disk with much smaller SSD part. So you have to calculate a bit. So we calculated when we deployed 25 VMs with 10 gigabyte test files, the footprint on our virtual disk would be 250 gigabytes plus the operating system. So maybe it's 15. We have 15 gigabytes or
times 25. Yeah, plus 10.
Yeah, times 25. So it's 375. And we don't need the zeros. We really need where is data in there.
Yeah.
So 375. To get our online tiering work, we have to fill up our SSD part to 60%. We have seen that in the other video with ReFS. When the performance tier, the SSD tier, gets to 60%, it starts moving the coldest data to the capacity tier. So this would be 60% divided by... No, it's times 375 times 0.6. So our SSD part, if we fill up 225, right?
Then you reach 60%, and then you start tiering. Yeah.
So if we create an SSD part of 375, or let's use 300 gigabytes for SSD and one terabyte or 700 gigabytes for HDD. So you
take 150. I mean, it just.
Yeah, it would be move the data even earlier. Yeah? Yeah. If we reach 100 gigabytes usage, it would move the data around. So you create not. All you don't give away all the space that it's available. You create much smaller virtual disks.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so you can test you can do your tests under worser conditions than the optimal ones. And
that exactly.
Gives you a feel for what it can do.
Exactly. So my friend, I think we are nearly at the end of the Hyper-V Amigo showcast. So
probably any other tips? I don't know. Get your Rocky configured correctly.
That's so true. So you have to have RDMA working correctly. Otherwise, Storage Spaces Direct is not your friend.
Well, let's face it. You have to have your S2D deployments done right because, part of the test, of course, of VMFleet is not just finding the peak performance under the best conditions and the worst conditions, but also discovering the fact that you might have messed up somewhere.
Yeah. Totally right. So, assuming you have a good working S2D setup, if you don't know how to do that, I have some webinars out there. This is a nice segue to this little promotion. So, I do webinars in English nearly every month, and I've done four or five already about storage. And if you want get some insights on S2D, go to this URL and you can sign up for our webinars and watch all the recorded ones, and they are all recorded. And if you are from the German speaking audience, we have a 3-day course about S2D where we teach our real world experience from over 30 S2D deployments already. We do a lot of S2D deployments and we learned a lot, and there's a lot to learn. So if you are from the German speaking area, go to our powercourse.net, powercourse.net website and see when you're interested, when there is a course, a training.
Do you have any plans to do something in English? Because I every time somebody asks me, I need to get more hands-on, I need to get more insight into S2D, whether they are other vendors or partners or whatever, I say, there's a great course, and it's in Germany, and it's in the Schöne Sauerland, so why not?
I can do it in English. I can do it in English if we have enough interest. for that. We can do one English one, but in the moment it's in German. But if you are interested, shoot me a mail to or go to thepowercourse.net. Click on one of the times of the course, and you can shoot me a mail and write in there that you are interested in an English version. But I've plans to do some video courses about S2D in English, because I know there is not so much knowledge out there, and I just have to find the time, because doing video courses is very time intensive and you can't be disturbed, and that's a problem. So I'm thinking about video courses about S2D, paid ones, but they will be not so expensive as online training. I want to do one last promotion here. And Didier, you know, we will have the CDC conference again in May 2018. So this is 5 months away. And this time we will have two tracks, English speaking tracks. So if you are from the German speaking area, of course, this is your conference. We have 2 days. We have over 40 community sessions led by MVPs and some Microsoft techies. This is the third time the conference takes place, and Didier, you will be a third time speaker, right?
Yes, I will. I've already noted down 3 days of vacation I need to take in May, so that's already taken care of.
Yeah.
And the last two editions were a great success. It's amazing to see the enthusiasm, the real life knowledge, the enthusiasm, the passion of the speakers and the attendees. It's not a huge conference in numbers if you compare it to Ignite or something, but
yeah.
The quality of both the organizers, the speakers and the attendees make for really a great learning experience. You really emerge in so many technologies, and it's not marketing, you know. It's really look, this is how it's done, this is what works, what doesn't work, these are the things you need to take care of, pay attention to. So for what it's worth, if you can go and you find the time to go, really do so. It's not expensive, it just takes some time, but learning is always going to take time, and this is a great way to do it.
Yeah, and we will have two pre-day events on the 14th. We will have the Hyper-V community and the Hybrid Cloud community. You were also speaker last year at the Hyper-V community meetup, and it's because we know all the speakers. We really know them. They are MVP friends, and they are handpicked. The speakers are handpicked, so we have really. Great feedback from the attendees. We had last year for the 32 sessions. This year, it was in May this year, right? We had an average of 7.98 on a scale from 1 to 9, where 9 is the best. So the ratings of the talks were very high. And this is really amazing. But look at the website. It's unfortunately in German, but we will have at least two tracks in English, and there are so many English-speaking speakers there. We have still German sessions there, but I think it's very interesting, and you will find things to watch. Okay, I think my time has now reached the 2 hour mark. I don't know, I started the recording a little bit earlier, so I don't know if we are already at 2 hours or not, but we are.
Well, we are at 2 hours.
that concludes our longest showcast so fast, my friend, right? So far, well, not so fast, so far.
Well, some things take time.
Yeah.
Right? I mean,
so if you stayed with us to the end, we want to thank you, because it's a marathon, right? but I think we didn't have a lot of time in there that was not giving you something.
Yeah, there we go.
And we plan to do that at least every 2 months, I assume, Didier. And
that's what we hope to do.
Yeah, and we have a nice lineup for more showcasts.
Yeah, we have some more stuff to show you, and I think it's the thing is there's a lot of items to focus on today on the on-premises side of things, but also the hybrid cloud, or even in the public cloud with IIS. But a lot of people leave a lot of high-value features on the sideline because they don't have time or take the time to look at them.
Yeah.
And we're going to try and change that and show you how you can very quickly leverage some of the features that you already have to have a better experience and a better result.
That's true, yeah. So with these words, I think we should conclude this session, and it's our Christmas session for this year because we will not do another one in December. So let's conclude with we wish you all a nice Christmas, and Didier, and a happy
New Year.
Bye.